There we go. All right. So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you are. We have 18 people now in the session. Hello, Alexei. And this session is going to be how to actually build a game with less than 13 kilobytes of JavaScript. And this is the rough agenda for today. I'm not entirely sure if the timing is correct. We will have to see, I guess. But there will be a fair bit of coding. So please bear with me. So we will have to have some session about some timing about how to set up the dev environment. There will be a web tool, and there will be also the chance to actually use, you know, any sort of coding environment as Visual Studio Code, if you like. And then afterwards, after the coding session, I'm going to tell you a little bit about tools and potential helpers to use. And then I'm happy to answer or refer any particular question that you may have. So let's see. So I'm Sascha Leopold. I'm working for eBay as an engineering manager, and I'm actually a JavaScript developer as long as I can really tell and think. I'm also the author behind SQLize, which is this Node.js ORM, and I'm a father of three kids, which usually means I'm rather tired because of, you know, short nights and so on and so forth. But today, let's see how it goes. I hope I can kind of relay the message I want to send here. I'm working for eBay, as said, which is, as you probably know, a global commerce leader. We have really tech teams all around the globe, you know, Australia, Germany, Spain, in the US, obviously, in Israel. So basically everywhere. And we also have a tech blog, which you may want to have a look into if you want to understand what we are doing in terms of technology and architecture and so on and so forth. So feel free to check out tech.ebayinc.com. And as all the bigger tech companies, obviously, we are also hiring. So if you are looking for a new job, feel free to scan this QR code in the bottom right corner. And I'm just pausing here for a tiny moment in case you want to take a photo. Right. So this entire session is coming out of the JS13K Games competition, which is something that just started last Thursday. It's basically a game coding competition around so building HTML5 games using, you know, the default web technologies that you have nowadays, including obviously JavaScript and CSS and so on and so forth, but also any sort of things when it comes to having blockchains, for example, in the browser and so on and so forth. The idea is that you build a game which can be at most, must be at most 13 kilobytes in size, including all the assets that you may need, all the libraries that you may need, every particular service that you may want to connect against. It should all be in those 13 kilobytes. And every year there is a new theme suggested which your game might relate to. And this year's theme is actually space. So what would be more relevant than actually building an asteroid clone is what we are doing today. And just to give you an understanding of what 13 kilobytes really means, which is, you know, today's exercise. So back in the days, you probably recall, I hope at least, the majority of those games. We had Prince of Persia in 1990. It was around about 260 kilobytes in size. We had this racing game here, Lotus, around about 1 megabyte actually. We had the original Pong, which was 113 already, and we also had Snake on the mobile phone, which weighed around like 6 kilobytes, just to have something for comparison. But then also, given, you know, technological evolution and everything that your browser offers nowadays, this is also what you can do in 13 kilobytes, really. So, you know, you have access to WebGL layers, you have access to different kind of CSS functionalities, and obviously the entire game landscape can be based on technology that is actually supported by the browser already. So you can actually do quite a lot with only 13 kilobytes of code. And what we are going to do today is we are going to use a framework which is called Contra.js. And this framework is actually built by Steven Lambert. Is he still here? Yes, I see Steven. So shout out to Steven here at this point, Steven Lambert, he's the guy behind Contra.js. And what this library really is focusing on is first of all, like asset loading, and then also the game loop, which I'm going to explain in just a moment. And then there's also functionality to interact with the game itself. So you can react to user input. And then there are other things that you might find interesting when you actually build a game. And this library, this framework is already 5 kilobytes in size gzip. So that's already quite big when you compare to the overall threshold of 13 kilobytes. But you will actually also find out that first of all, the remaining, what is it, 7 kilobytes or 8 kilobytes, they are actually good enough. And then also you can kind of remove certain aspects of Contra.js just in case you don't need it because it's modular. And you can just tell, okay, this is, I need the core, I need, you know, the asset loading mechanism, and I need the game loot, and the rest I don't really care about, so I can just remove it. And yeah, as said, this framework was really built with JS for Tinker Games in mind. And just to give an example of what was built with this library in the past, this is one of the games I was building, I believe 2 years ago or something like this. And just so, which is like a mobile game. And what Contra really offers here now is like interacting to any sort of user input, but also those graphics here, they are kind of loaded and rendered by Contra.js. And then like the entire way you update the screen and you render stuff, this is all built by using this Contra.js lifecycle management. And there are obviously many more other games which you might want to look into, but for the moment it doesn't really matter, I guess. And the overall goal of today's workshop is, first of all, understanding like the core principles behind game development, which in particular will be the game loop itself, and then also how do you actually update entities, let's call it, inside of your game universe, and how you can basically interact with these kind of entities to begin with. And we are going to learn all about this while building an Asteroids clone, so something that you can see in the right bottom right corner. And just in case you don't happen to know Asteroids, there is obviously a video about stuff like this. So, you know, this is like the original game where, you know, you have the spaceship, you can shoot those asteroids, and then you, if they are rather bigger asteroids, they are kind of breaking apart and are creating, forming new asteroids around you. And you can kind of use thrusters to kind of accelerate this ship. And you can also decelerate, but just by not hitting the accelerate button anymore, and then you can move around. That's the overall idea behind this game. And yeah, this session is really based on a tutorial that Steven actually built in the past. I'm just going to share it here. There we go. And the code that we are going to build can be found here. And I'm actually going to work in this repository, but that's rather optional. You may want to download it, or you may want to just open it so you can kind of copy and paste stuff if you don't feel like, you know, typing all the code that you will see in a moment. So this can also, this can always be used, can be used as a reference to, you know, take this code and either paste it or just read through it in your time that you need. Right. So the first step before we can actually start developing, obviously, is setting up the environment itself. And there is a tool which is called WebMaker App, and I'm going to paste it here, which allows you to, you know, you basically have a canvas on the right-hand side. You can write HTML here, and it will automatically appear on the right-hand side. You can also add CSS over here, and you can add JavaScript over here. And you can use this to create a game, first of all. So you might want to actually go with this WebMaker application, or as I will show you in a moment, you can also download this repository and run everything on your computer itself, and then run it in your local browser if you prefer this. But anyway, the first step will be that inside of the HTML, we are going to create a canvas with a certain particular width. Where is my web? There we go. With a certain particular width and height. So we are just creating here a canvas now in the HTML, which has 600 pixels in width and also 600 pixels in height. So we have this already. And then the next step would be that we kind of make this visible for starters. So I'm just going to do, you know, I'm just going to say, okay, the background of my entire document is going to be black. And then instantly you see on the right-hand side how it's switching to, how it's updated basically. Also, when you open WebMaker app, you will find a gear icon on the bottom right corner. If you press it, the settings you will find under Fun, the so-called JS 13K Games mode, which when you enable it, you will see on the bottom of the screen, you will see like this file size calculation over here. So it tells you, okay, this is the amount of code you already have used, and this is the remaining code that you can use actually. And now if we, you know, the moment you add more code over here, it will update and eventually tell you, okay, now you have used more code. So, you know, the more you actually develop the code, you will actually see on the bottom, okay, obviously the more code you have used and the closer you're getting to the 13 kilobytes boundary that we are facing. Okay, so this is WebMaker app. You may want to use it, or you want to potentially use the Git repository. And the first step would be that we are making use of, can I copy this? We want to actually make use of Contra.js, and you can do this in the WebMaker app. I'm going to paste the link over here. You can do this in WebMaker app by clicking this Add Library button over here. And when you paste in any sort of JavaScript library over here, it will be automatically pulled and be used inside of your game. So now that we have added Contra to our WebMaker application, you can see already on the bottom that it weighs around about like 5.5 kilobytes. Into your extra game, so you have the remaining stuff. You have place for the rest of the game actually in here. I'm just pausing here for any questions that may have arose so far. So what you should have learned about is that we are going to use Contra.js, which is a game framework, game making framework in JavaScript, which is going to use the canvas, which is here. And there is the WebMaker application, which allows you to kind of build a game or any sort of web application in this view. And you can actually see the size on the bottom when you press the gear on the bottom right corner, settings. And under fun, you find this JS13K games mode. And the moment you enable it, once you close it again, this size calculation should appear again on the bottom. All right. So the alternative to actually using this thing over here is the following. You can clone this repository. I'm going to share it with you. And when you do so, you will find this particular code base over here. And you can just run, well, first of all, run yarn install or just yarn to install all dependencies. And the moment you run yarn start afterwards, you will find, well, first of all, this output on the command line, but then also if you open that page, you will find this particular page. And I'm just pausing you for a moment in case you want to copy it over. All right. So in this repository, you will find a couple of directories, and all of them, they do refer to a particular step in this tutorial. So later on, I'm going to tell you that we are now going to create, for example, an asteroid, and you will find a directory over here, which is kind of a copy of the code that we are going to create. You will also find a playground, which is the area I'm going to develop in now. And you know, the moment you feel like you don't want to copy this or you don't want to type this into your computer, you can just open any of these directories to get the code that you will need and to paste it in this either playground, or you just check out the code itself, which is written here. Totally up to you. But long story short, we are going to look into the playground, and this is not exactly a copy of what I was just pasting in the WebMaker app, except for the fact that I was also changing the border of the canvas. So in here, if you wanted to use this, just in order to actually see where, you know, where's the canvas, you can make the border white and then you see exactly where you are and what you're talking about. All right, and just in case someone here doesn't really know what a canvas is to begin with. So a canvas is an HTML element which allows you to draw on it. And you can draw on it through the so-called, where is it here? Canvas rendering context. And there are different kinds of contexts, but we're going to use the so-called 2D context today. And when you have this context, you can essentially, you know, you can move like a cursor kind of around, and you can draw lines and you can fill certain areas and so on and so forth. And this is what what Contra.js is essentially using under the hood. And by the way, Stephen, if I talk rubbish, please interrupt me. Okay, so I do assume now that you have the Isa WebMaker app initialized, or you have downloaded the code base and you have opened it in your any sort of text editor or any sort of IDE. And then we can basically just jump into straight away. Okay, so first of all, the first thing that you will learn today is, what's a sprite? So in Contra, one of the most essential bits and pieces is the so-called sprite. And I'm going to open this here. There we go. And the sprite is essentially an entity in your game, which has usually a certain coordinates and a certain visual appeal, let's call it, and which has a certain lifetime, life cycle. And there are different kinds of sprites in Contra.js, like in homemade supported version. And there's for once the idea of a rectangle sprite, which is just a sprite which has a certain X and Y coordinate and then also a certain width and height. And you can give it a color, and then the moment you declare this, Contra will render this particular rectangular for you. And then also, Contra supports image sprites. That means you can basically say, okay, I have this particular image on my hard drive and I want Contra to load it somehow and render it on the canvas. So you can do this by actually creating a JavaScript image, and then you can tell the sprite, okay, my image actually is here. And then when you render the sprite, it will, obviously display the particular image on your canvas. And last but not least, there is also, custom sprites. And these sprites, they do have a custom render function here. And in this custom render function, you can essentially, you have access to the 2D canvas render, to this 2D context that you have because of the canvas itself. So you can access now these kind of functions over here inside of your render function of your sprite. So you see here the this.context.fillStyle. That's exactly the same as these kind of methods over here. So this context here is essentially this.context. And because you have access to this custom render function, and because you have access to this context, you can pretty much draw whatever you like on the canvas while it's still within the lifecycle of the sprite engine. Okay. So now the first step that we want to do today is we want to actually create an asteroid. And for starters, because we want to keep it easy and simple, an asteroid for us will only be a circle. Okay, so now inside of your Code.js application, Code.js file, we are going to create an asteroid. I'm just going to basically, you have this file over here, and we are going to now type below this contra init line. And I'm just going to move this up a little bit so you can see the code, which is on my screen here. And there you go. And I'm just going to type essentially what is on this particular slide. So maybe let's do the following. I'm copy and pasting this in my file here, and I'm going to explain exactly what it is doing so you can see it on my screen. So basically, we are creating a variable which is called asteroid, obviously, and we are making use of Contra sprite function, which is generating you a sprite. Each of those sprites usually have a certain coordinate. So here in our case, we're telling this sprite to be at the x coordinate 100 and y coordinate 100 as well. Let's just ignore these two properties for the moment. And instead, we are basically also telling this sprite, you have a radius of 30 pixels in that case. And afterwards, we are telling this asteroid, this sprite, to render itself. And I'm just going to show you what's happening, and then I'm going to explain a bit more what's actually doing. So if you kind of copy this, and again, the code actually is also in this directory over here, create asteroid. If you take this code, it will render this particular circle at this particular static position. And what you can see here, this X and Y position, it basically means on the top left corner, there is like the origin of this canvas, which is always the position 0, 0. And if we are going 100 pixels to the right, which is for the X, and 100 pixels down, which is for Y, and we end up in the very center of this circle. And the code over here, we are making use of the canvas context, and we are basically saying, okay, at the position where you are, which is by default, you know, which is the position that we have here in our sprite, we are going to draw an arc basically, which has this particular center and this particular radius, which is 30 here. And it starts from 0, and it has basically does a full circle because we are telling it is going to be 2 times p. So because of this, basically start drawing a circle and you go once around the entirety of this arc. It's starting here and it's going to draw a line all around the circle itself. And in the canvas, there's basically the idea of you have like you're drawing paths which you cannot see, but then afterwards, once you have finished drawing the path, you can either fill this path or you can make a stroke, which is basically generating this outline around this particular circle. So what we have done here is we are telling the 2D canvas, please save the following stroke style, which is it should be just white. And then afterwards, once we have finished drawing this path, we want to make a stroke which generates this outline. So you can also here, for example, do blue if you like, and then it's obviously turning blue, but you can also say instead of actually making a stroke, we want to fill this with, I don't know, gray, for example. And now here you can do this.context.fill, and then we should have a circle which has a white outline or a white stroke, and it is filled with the color gray. So here again, we are referring to the logic that you have available through the canvas context. And in our case, we just want to have an asteroid, which is just a white outline. And I'm going to explain in a moment what these two lines are all about. There is a note from Steven. Steven, feel free to talk if you like.
Okay, it's just a note between differences of version 6 and version 7, depending on what version you grab.
I can't hear you if you were talking.
Oh, you couldn't hear me?
Doesn't work. Really? Then it's me. Wait a second. Huh, maybe now. Can you talk again?
Can you hear me now?
Yes, perfect. I was on mute apparently.
Ah, there you go. Now, I was just noting that depending on what version of Contra, version 6, you use this.x and this.y in the arc call. But in version 7, you would use 0, 0.
Okay.
So it just depends. If someone grabbed the latest version and it wasn't working, that would be the reason.
I see. Okay. Yeah, I was actually making use of Contra 6 because it would work more easily in a WebMaker app because it doesn't automatically minify the code. And that's why you will have issues with this size calculation over here. But in particularly, if you don't really care about the file size itself, you can also totally go with the unminified version of Contra, or you build the minification step into your project yourself. All right. So what you should have now on your computer is, actually let me move this here, is the screen. It's already amazing, isn't it? okay, so you can see on the left-hand side here on this particular document how there is like this outline. So we have covered now create an asteroid, and as I said, this is kind of referring to now the directory, which is create asteroid. And then now we are focusing on the game loop itself, and there is a directory called game loop and so on and so forth. So later on, the moment we continue working on this, on the slide deck here, you will find always a reference on the left-hand side, which is referring to a directory in this code base over here. All right, game loop. So a game loop basically is mechanism which will ensure that your game is updated so many times per second. So nowadays in computer games, you usually try to optimize for 60 frames per second or 60 updates per second. So that means your entities inside of your game are updated 60 times per second, but also ideally the graphics, the like visuals inside of your game are updated 60 times per second. There's obviously always room for growth. So there are certain games, certain gamers in particular, who try to optimize for even more. But usually consensus is that you try to optimize for 60 frames per second. Or if your hardware is just too underpowered, let's say 30 frames per second also do suffice. But usually this game loop optimizes for 60 updates per second. And this is exactly what Contra, and I hope that is correct, Steven, what Contra is optimizing for and what Contra is kind of guaranteeing you. And so what this game loop really is doing, all it's really doing essentially is it does make sure that you call this update method 60 times per second and you call this render method 60 times per second, and that's essentially it. And that's all the magic really behind any sort of game loop, that you only really make sure all your entities are updated this amount of times per second and re-rendered this amount of times per second, so in that case, 60. And we are going to create this game loop by using the Contra's game loop function. And I'm going to continue working in this directory, in this file over here. So we have our asteroid, and here now we are using the game loop function to kind of instantiate a new game loop. And it has an update method, it has a render method. And once you have created this game loop, we just start the game loop, which will basically cause Contra to, to re-render for you 60 times per second. And now since we have inside of this render method over here, since we are already rendering our asteroid, I can just remove this line over here, which is no longer needed. And what will happen now is it will actually move the asteroid somewhere. And I'm going to explain in a moment why this is. But long story short, because we have the game loop now, this particular piece of line, this particular piece of code over here is now executed multiple times per second. And then also afterwards, we do call this. So the asteroid is updated and the asteroid is re-rendered 60 times per second now. Okay. You know, if there are questions, totally feel free to ask, feel free to write them in the chat. That's all perfectly fine. And I want to explain why the hell this asteroid is now moving where it was previously just a static thing. And the reason for this are those two lines that we have over here. This, the X property and the Y property essentially stands for the delta of X every time you update this asteroid. So every time we call asteroid.update, what's really happening inside now is we take this asteroid has a certain X and Y position, and we do add DX and DY on top of the existing like initial 100 that we have over here. So when you actually spawn this asteroid, when the application is loaded, we do create a random value between -2 and 2 and assign this to DX and DY. And now every time, asteroid.update is actually executed, it will deduct or add, depending on if it's positive or negative, to or from this X property over here. So if it was 100, and if let's say this DX is 2 in the beginning, then in the first iteration, X would be 100, second iteration, it would be 102, and so on and so forth. And because of this, it is slowly, slowly moving across the screen now. So as you can see here now, X is, I guess, a little bit negative, Y would be a little bit positive. And here now, Y is almost 0 because it doesn't really move downwards here, but it was moving to the right. So this is where it's coming from, and this is why it's now moving. So you have to recall those particular properties because they're going to play a bigger role in the moment. But long story short, with DX and DY, you can automatically kind of move around stuff when you call the update method on those sprites. All right, so this is what you should have now. Yeah, how is this going? You are my reference now here today.
So far, so good.
Excellent.
Learned something new about this canvas I didn't know before.
Okay. Second, as you have probably seen in the video, in the original asteroid game, what happens there is basically you have asteroids, and when they hit a boundary of your game, the border of the game, they are reappearing on the other side of the game and of the game area, actually. So basically here, you know, when we have an asteroid which is moving somewhere over here, it should actually automatically reappear once it has crossed this particular line over here. It should reappear on the other side. This is roughly what it is supposed to do. And this is what we're going to focus on now. And it's actually quite straightforward, I would almost say. So we have our game loop over here. And what we are doing so far is we are calling the update method. Now in here, we can actually check, okay, did this asteroid already cross any sort of these boundaries that we have on our canvas? And in order to actually know this, we actually have to get access to the canvas first, which we can easily get by using contra.getCanvas. And just, I'm not sure if I can make it any bigger. So you can see it here. So we do get access to the canvas by calling contra.getCanvas over here. And then afterwards, we can basically check, okay, is the position of the asteroid on the X or on the Y axis, does it cross any particular boundaries? Deepak is going to drop off. Enjoy your evening, I guess. So what we can do here is really, we can do if the asteroid's X is smaller than zero, which means it went to the left border and it basically would disappear now any moment. We can say the asteroid's X position is going to be the canvas width, which means if it hits this particular border over here, we tell the X property to be exactly the width of the canvas, which means it's on this particular area over here. And let's see if it already works. So now it should actually appear over here, which it works. And now it's going to, you know, disappear on the top because we haven't told it otherwise just yet. And we can do the same for Y. So if the asteroid hits the very top of our canvas, we are going to actually set the Y coordinate to its height. So it's going to, if it's hitting the top border here, it's going to reappear on the very bottom. Let's see if this works. And it does not. What? Why is that? It does really help. There we go. Let's go. It did work. I didn't really refresh, apparently. And we are just going to do the same for the other sides, which boils down to the fact that we are going to check if the position on the x-axis is already matching the width of the canvas. In that case, we're going to tell it, okay, please move to the left in the sense of the x-coordinate is going to be y. And similarly, if the y-property is equal or bigger than the canvas height, we're going to tell y should be zero. So now if we refresh here, we should actually see, let's see, something like this. That appears on the bottom if it hits the top corner, and then also it appears on the left-hand side if it hits the right bottom. So now we have a movement that's already kind of vaguely reminding of the original asteroids game. And this is what you ideally would have now. Okay. Any questions, any problems, anything else just yet? Nope. Okay. All right. So the next step, in order to actually now scale this up, we are going to do a tiny refactoring on this game, which is, so far we were always kind of only focusing on one particular asteroid or one particular sprite. And we are now going to change this in the sense of we are going to have an array of sprites And every time the game loop is updating, we are also going to update any sprite that has been created just yet. So in order to do this, we are going to create an array, which is the sprites array. And we are also going to create a function which will allow us to actually create asteroids on the fly. So we're going to do this. Hello, Andrzej. So now we have an sprites array. We have a function which is creating an asteroid for us, which is exactly the same logic as before, except now it's actually like reusable in that sense. And we can now just push the result of this function into our sprites array. And now obviously we no longer have an asteroid variable over here. So we are just going to iterate over all of these sprites. And for each of the sprites inside of this array, we're going to call the update method on it. We can simply do this by doing this. And I'm going to rename this to sprite, which doesn't work. Why doesn't it work? So now in here, we are iterating over each and every sprite, and we are always updating each and every sprite. And we do also check for each sprite that we have, you know, did it hit the outside boundaries of the actual canvas? And if so, we are doing this transition to the other side of the canvas. And we're going to do the same here. So we are calling for each of the sprites, we are calling the render method. And I'm just going to quickly show you what will happen now, but essentially it should still look the same because it didn't really, we still only have one particular asteroid over here and it's exactly the same, behaving exactly the same. But it's now scalable in the sense of, you know, the more sprites we're now putting into this array, it will automatically re-update first of all, and then also render. And yeah, you will find the code for this inside of your scaling directory list. But in general, as said, the idea is really we have one function which is creating us an asteroid sprite, and we are going to push this sprite inside of our into our sprites direct into our sprites, what is it, array. So now that we have like one somewhat scalable solution to kind of handle sprites and update sprites all the time, we can also easily now just create more than one asteroid by pushing several times into this array. And we can, you know, just make use of this, of the for function here. We're going to create, I don't know, some sprites into this. And we should now have multiple asteroids at once. Okay, so far nothing really special. As said, it's now a little bit more scalable. So anytime any sprite that we might want to render, we can just push it into the sprites array and it will automatically appear because it's part of the game loop now. Andrzej, do you want to say something? At least for me, you are highlighted somehow.
I can say hi. And I just joined and I'm just catching up, so not much more right now.
Okay, perfect. This might be a chance to actually submit a game this year.
I don't think so.
Ah. Okay,
I can always try.
You should submit the asteroid clone.
Yeah, that's actually like the maximum I could think of, considered how much time I could spend on building something, or I can cheat and try to do Triska in space or something like that, replacing the background.
So just for anyone who doesn't know, Andrzej is the person behind JS Cernica Games, so welcome. And
sorry for being a little bit late.
Okay, so now that we have those asteroids flying around, kind of transitioning from one page to the other or from one side to the other, we now actually want to focus on building the player's ship. And I was doing this just earlier today, and you know what's coming up next is really a little bit about mathematics, and this is going to be quite interesting for those at least who aren't too much into game development. So let's see how this is going. So first of all, we are again making use of Contrast Sprite engine, and again we are going to have a custom sprite. And what our ship is really going to look like essentially is like this, a triangle. And we will make use of the canvas's context capabilities to actually draw basically lines or paths. So what we're going to do now is we are going to create a ship variable, just somewhere doesn't really matter, maybe here. And again, it's going to be a contrast sprite, and we're just going to put it somewhere. So let's say 300. And it's also going to have a render function, but also a particular width. So this width will be used after, like at a later point, to actually detect collisions between the ship itself and then some asteroids potentially. So we are just going to copy it over here as well. And now this render function, what it's really doing is we are telling the canvas to actually start a path, begin a path. And then we move around this path somewhere, and then eventually we close it again and create a stroke around it. And as you can probably tell from this code here, Stephen is sending tricks. That's good. What you might be able to tell from the code here basically is we have a certain X and Y property, as you can tell here, spanner 300 in that case. And then we're going to move around the I always call it cursor, but whatever you call this, like the path. First to this particular position over here, and then to the like on top of the actual current Y position. And then we move it back down, which basically is kind of describing this particular path over here. So we are kind of forming this particular shape. And I'm just going to take this. So what we are doing here is we are creating this variable first of all, so it will not appear anywhere obviously just yet, because we will still have to push it into our sprites array. Ship. And if we are lucky, we should see our ship. There we go. So currently you cannot move it, currently doesn't transition from one place to another, but we just have it here, it's static, it also doesn't crash or anything, but essentially we have this triangle shaped ship over here now. Okay, so quick recap on what we were doing just yet. You should have learned by now that a game usually comes with a so-called game loop, which is something that takes care of your sprites and updates all those sprites or entities and updates all your entities and re-render them on a particular area. In our case, it's the canvas, the web canvas. Also, there are different kind of shapes inside Contra.js itself. So you have those sprites, which are by default either rectangular or you can print images. Or they can have custom shapes, which you kind of define by its own render function. We have also seen how you can make static movements in the sense of, you give it some direction and it will just always go this way, unless you tell it otherwise. But essentially, like this dx property, that's the most important part. This dx and dy property tells an object, an entity, to move into a certain particular direction anytime you call update on it. Questions? All right. The next step would be that we actually want to interact with our game. So the stuff that we do control is the ship itself, and Contra allows you to kind of observe key presses, and then afterwards you can react to those kind of presses. And there is a function inside of Contra which is called initKeys. And this basically tells Contra, okay, please do now observe key presses, and then afterwards it can ask Contra by the key pressed function, is that particular key currently pressed or not? And we are going to make use of this inside of our actual ship. So first of all, before we can use it, we have to tell Contra, please init our keys. And then once you have done this, we can always make use of Contra.keyPressed. With some key up, for example. And this will return you a Boolean, which will be true if the up key is currently pressed, or if it's not, then it will return false. And we're going to make use of this inside of our ship entity itself, ship sprite. And we're going to create a custom update function over here. So this update function is called every time you call, update on this particular sprite. And by default, what it's really doing, it is calling a function which is called advance, if I'm not completely mistaken. So this.advance. And let's quickly have a look if it still works. Well, it doesn't move just yet, so I guess it will work. So we do draw it once. It doesn't really crash, so I assume it does work for the moment at least. So what I'm just going to copy this part because it's just boilerplate at this point. We're going to replace it in just a moment. But really what we can see here is, bye bye Nyad. Inside of the update function, you can basically now, you basically have access to this key pressed functionality, and you can ask control, okay, is this key now pressed? In this case, is our left button pressed? If so, we're going to move this to the left a little bit. If the right button is pressed, we are going to move it to the right a little bit. And what this allows you to do now is you can move around this ship. Now, obviously, as you have seen in the original video, in the original version of Asteroids, you don't really move your ship around, you rather rotate it and you have thrusters to accelerate and decelerate. And what we want to do instead really is we want to kind of rotate our ship to begin with. And then afterwards, we're going to focus on the actual movement acceleration part. Now, this whole idea of rotating something inside of the canvas is a little bit funny, because you don't really rotate a particular object inside of the canvas, but you rotate the entire canvas, draw on something, and then rotate it back. And this whole rotation idea inside of at least the canvas, if not JavaScript at all, is usually not using like degrees, but rather radians, which is a little bit funny to explain, but you basically describe an angle by telling how much of a distance you have been walking on the outline of a circle. And, 1p, exactly one times p, you end up on this particular, so you're kind of describing this outline here until this point. And then 2 times p, you basically end up on this particular area over here. So you have like these numbers that you're using when you're using radians. And we are going to make use of a rotation property over here, which we're going to interpret in the render function afterwards. So I'm just going to copy this particular helper function to somewhere, maybe just here, which is converting, first of all, like degrees into radians. And then second, we're going to add a rotation property to the ship, which will let us know in the future, okay, the ship has been, because you have pressed the buttons, the ship has been rotated to the left or to the right. And by default, 0 radians basically means something is pointing to the right direction, towards the right. And now this is like the original code that you have right now, and we're going to change this. So as said, when you actually rotate something inside on the canvas, you don't really rotate the object itself, but you do rotate parts of your canvas. You draw something there, and then you rotate it back. And you can do this by actually saving your current canvas context. That's what you do first. And just going to put this here. Before we draw anything, we do basically save the current context, which you do by running this. So this.contextsave is basically telling, do please take a snapshot right now of this canvas, and then afterwards we can manipulate it somehow, and then afterwards restore it again. And inside of the canvas context, there is a function which is called translate, which allows you to kind of move the origin of your canvas somewhere else. So this particular case, we are kind of moving now the origin of the canvas to the center of our ship with this particular piece of code here. No, perfect. So if you use Ctrl 7, you don't have to do this apparently. It will do this automatically for you. So in that case, I'm just going to quickly copy and paste this over, because then it doesn't really matter if you're going with Conqueror 7 in the long run. But again, basically, you know, you kind of move around the canvas, you rotate something, and afterwards you draw the path. And then once the alignment is drawing, you are restoring the original canvas back. Okay, so now because, let me also put this. There we go. So now when we press the left and the right button, we don't really want to change the X and the Y property anymore, but instead we actually want to change this rotation property here. Because the moment we change the rotation property, it will have an effect on the actual canvas itself, which means it will kind of rotate around this object on the canvas itself. And essentially it really boils down to what we have already here. So we are going to make use of the left and right button. And if the left button is pressed, we rotate it a little bit to the left. And if the right button is pressed, it's the other way around. And apparently I was using 4 here, so I'm just going to copy this. So now here, if we press left, it is basically decreasing our rotation, which means it's going to turn a little bit to the left. If we go, if we press right, it's increasing its rotation property, so it's rotating to the right. So we can now rotate our ship. All right. Now, thrusting acceleration. So that's going to be a bit interesting, because you will now learn something about, first of all, a geometry, I guess. And then also there is a property inside of Canvas which is called DDX. And I hope that's still the same in Conqueror 7. So DDX basically is a delta to the DX property. And as I have mentioned earlier, so you have this X property, which is just telling the canvas, you know, please draw something on this particular position. And then DX is, you know, how much do you move around how much do you change your X property when you actually call update? And DDX is now an update to this DX property that you have, that we have already seen. So you can basically say every time we call update, first of all, we do change DX by the amount DDX is set. And then also, because of this, it can kind of smoothly accelerate and decelerate certain motions. And we are going to make use of this in our update function over here. So inside of our ship, we do calculate now based on this one, you know, where is your ship currently pointing towards? And because of this angle that we are describing here with the rotation property, you can kind of calculate how much is your ship going to a particular X and Y position right now, in the sense of you know, pointing towards something. So you can use cosine and sine to actually calculate these particular distances over here. And we are going to make use of this to actually accelerate the ship into this particular position. And basically, you know, we do calculate this. We again convert this rotation, which is a number, into the degrees. And then afterwards, we are going, if you actually press up, we're going to manipulate this DDX and DDY property, which is the delta to the DX and DY property. We are manipulating it to be, to kind of move the ship towards the directions already pointing to. And the moment we stop pressing the up button, actually, we kind of reset the DDX and DDY property. So it will no longer actually increase or decrease the DX and DY property afterwards anymore, which means it's going to have a constant movement again. So now here, you can actually press now up and it will move towards this direction. And the moment it hits any sort of boundary, because of the code that we have in our game loop, it's kind of transitioning to the other side of the screen. This is what you should have now. So now the funny part here is the longer you actually keep pressing up, the quicker the ship is now actually going to be. So there is no limit in that sense. So it's going to be super, super quick. which is something that we ideally want to limit because it's just unhandable. And now, you know, kind of reacting to any sort of asteroid is obviously almost impossible. And we can do this by calculating the magnitude behind like our ship's movement in that sense. And this is done by, so instead of our update function of the ship, we can kind of calculate what is the current movement speed, let's call it. And if our ship is moving like much more than a certain distance already, then we kind of cap it and we can reset the change, this, the X property and the Y property accordingly. So what's really happening here is we are calculating the magnitude, which is like the distance our ship is going to cross currently based on the DX and DY property. And then, you know, if this is above a certain threshold, we're just going to cut it short and make it a little bit smaller. So in here, we, you know, first of all, you do take ddx and ddy, which is manipulating dx. And then afterwards, once all of those movements are above a certain threshold, we are just cutting it short and telling, okay, please stop at this particular ratio over here. And now if you run it again, we should no longer have like unlimited speed in that sense, but we always move with a certain constant speed the moment we hit a particular threshold in that sense. All right. Is anyone still actually following? Perfect. At least somebody was giving thumbs up. That's great. The rest I don't know, but I hope you still follow. And if that was just too much or too quick, really, then I would suggest, first of all, take a look into the code base again, which, you know, I've referenced already earlier. But then also, if you need more explanation on the actual, you know, why are you doing this? How do you work with vectors? What is magnitude? And so on and so forth. Yeah, that's what I assumed it was rather quick. Then maybe have a look into this actual tutorial from Steven, because there are references to different kind of mathematical articles, and maybe it is explained a little bit more in depth. Anyway, what we have done so far is we have the sprite array, which takes all of our sprites and updates and render them. We have the asteroids, which we spawn 5, I believe, of right now when we start the game, and they are moving into a certain direction, and they do reappear on the other side of the canvas. And also we have built a ship which you can accelerate and which you can also rotate. And what's up next basically is shooting bullets. So we want to be able to press space. And then once we do this, we want to create a bullet in the front of our ship, which is moving towards the direction the ship is currently looking at. But it's supposed to be quicker than the actual ship itself. So that's roughly the idea. And in order to do this, we are going to create a helper function, which is called createBullet. And we pass it our ship. And then based on the ship's coordinates, we are going to kind of spawn this bullet and move it into a certain direction. That's roughly the plan. So again, let's create a function somewhere, maybe close to our createAsteroid function here. And we're going to call it createBullet. And actually, let me just copy this over. Again, you have to code in this repository. But let me just briefly explain what this really is doing. Again, we are, you know, you are retrieving the ship itself. So this function has access to our actual ship. And we are kind of calculating, you know, where is the ship currently looking, into which direction is the ship currently looking, and also which kind of motion is it describing, because this cosine and sine here afterwards is basically understanding, okay, the ship is looking into this direction, so this is roughly the movement it has. Also in here, in this function, we are creating a sprite again. And the sprite is going to have the same kind of X and Y position as the ship, plus some on top, so it actually appears in front of the actual ship itself. So on the very like top of the triangle. And then also in here, we are telling this bullet to move with the same speed as the ship based on the ship's DX and DY property. but then it should actually move a little bit faster so it doesn't really stick on the ship itself all the time. Last but not least, our bullet itself is just going to be a 2x2 pixels square in that sense, which is going to float around. So it's really just a tiny, tiny, well, almost dot on this canvas, which is going to move around. And there is this particular property in Contra in each of these sprites, which is TTL, which stands for time to live. And time to live basically describes, okay, these are the amount of frames this particular sprite will live, and afterwards it's going to die. And every time you call update on this particular sprite, this TTL is going to decrease, and the moment it hits zero, it's considered kind of dead or no longer alive, actually. Okay, so we have this function. We also have two kind of variables over here, which is allow bullet and bullet delay. And I'm going to explain in a moment what these are used for. But long story short, we do have a function now which allows you to create a bullet at the position where the ship is, and it will continuously kind of shoot into this direction where the ship was currently looking at when you pressed space later on. And what we want to do with this function now is we are going to call it when you press space. So inside of our ship, we no longer only observe pressing the left and the right button, but rather we also want to observe if the user has pressed space. So if the user was pressing space, we basically want to call this particular create bullet function. And we take the result and push it into our sprites array. Right, so we do create this bullet, we push it into the sprites, and because it will be part of the sprites array, it will automatically be rendered on the canvas itself. So this is what we want to do. So now every time we press space, it will create a bullet and it will be added to the sprites array. And let's see if this is working already. So now if you press it, you can see there are like actually a couple of them now. And also they are no longer actually disappearing, but rather kind of float around now everywhere. And the reason for this is twofold actually. First of all, what we should totally do is we should try to kind of prevent the user from creating too many bullets at once, because that's just kind of too easy for the actual game mechanics. We're going to make use of this allow bullet variable now. And in addition to actually checking that the user was just pressing space, we're also going to check if we can actually currently create a bullet, if we can spawn a new bullet. And if that's the case, so by default, that's true. Let's have a look here. So here's the variable. The moment, where's my code? Here we go. You know, the moment we enter this particular case now, so we have pressed space and we can still create a bullet, we are going to tell the code, okay, please no longer allow new bullets, but rather in you know, a certain amount of time, we want to allow it again. And we're going to go with, let's say 250 milliseconds. Every 250 milliseconds, we allow the user to actually shoot a bullet again. Right. Actually, we will make use of this bullet delay, which I've defined on the very top. Here it is, again, 250. So now if we run the game again, you can now press space, keep it pressed, and you can see how it's now creating a bullet every 250 milliseconds, and afterwards you have to wait a little bit and you can create one again. So now you can still see how they are floating around like crazy everywhere, and this is because there is a function in Contra which is called isAlive. And this isAlive function is basically telling you, okay, if the sprite originally has a TTL, and it has been passing zero already, then this is returning you false. Otherwise, it will always be true. And we're going to make use of this in our game loop, actually. So in here, our game on the very bottom, before we actually, you know, iterate over all those sprites, and before we actually update each sprite, we are throwing away every sprite which is dead in that sense. So we only want to keep sprites which are alive. Is that the function? Yes. So here now we basically say, okay, please kind of keep only these sprites which are still alive. And in case of our bullets, you know, the moment they have been rendered or updated 50 times, they will, you know, the TTL will be zero. And because of this, isAlive is going to return false, which means it's going to disappear from our JavaScript memory. Here now, you can just, you know, press this. And after 50 updates of this particular sprite, of this particular bullet, it will just disappear. And because Contra is updating the game 60 times per second, a TTL of 50 basically means it should disappear roughly after within 1 second, essentially. So this is like roughly the timeline, lifetime of a bullet that we have here. All right, so this is all about shooting bullets. And so what we have done now basically is we have those asteroids, we have the chip which you can move around, and we have those bullets that you can move around. So all that's now really left in that sense is you somehow have to identify, okay, did my ship actually hit any asteroids? So did it kind of die and, you know, collapse in that sense? And also on the other way around, did we actually hit any sort of bullet with our, any sort of asteroid with our bullet? And because of this, the asteroid should somehow break in that sense. This is what we are going to focus on now. And yeah, in order to actually do this, there are different kind of ways to detect collisions inside of games. There are usually rather simple ones where you kind of take the outline of your sprites or of your entities and understand, okay, are they overlapping somehow with something else? Because usually collision detection can be super, super expensive, so it will take lots of time unless you are using kind of naive and simple approaches. And in particular, I'm going to show you this link. In particular, when it comes to circles or anything which has an outline, there are rather easy and trivial kind of collision detection algorithms that you can use. I'm going to send you this link here. So long story short, when you want to understand if two kind of circles have collided, so in our case, if we consider our bullet a circle, in the end, it's a 2x2 square, which is almost a circle. You can always kind of calculate the distance between both circles or both entities. And if they are shorter than the actual radiuses of both entities combined, then they must overlap somehow. So that's overall the idea when you want to kind of understand, okay, do two circles overlap or two entities which are circle-like, do they overlap? And this is how you can calculate it. However, before we get there, we must somewhere find the position where we can actually check for collisions, you know, and this is done ideally inside of our game loop. So we have this game over here. And before we actually update our all of these sprites, we want to now actually add collision detection, because the moment they have been collided, we can somehow delete them or kill them, so they will be filtered out later on. And we are going to do this using the super old school for loops that we have here. Kudos to Steven. I was actually doing it earlier one more time and was actually using for each here, but for the sake of actually, you know, keeping it simple, we are going to go with for loops. So what you can see here now is we are iterating over all of those sprites that we have here. And we are only really catering for sprites which are asteroids. Now you can actually see here what I was doing earlier. Every time we have created any sort of sprite, here we have defined a type. So here this, you know, every time we call this create asteroid function, it's creating a sprite with the type asteroids. And also when we create a bullet, it's coming with the type bullet. And now here we are, you know, basically ignoring all sprites that aren't asteroids. But if the sprite is an asteroid, then again, we iterate over each and every sprite and check if the sprite now is not an asteroid. So in our case, that could be either the bullet or the ship. And then we are going to store those two variables, those two sprites in those variables over here. So we have access to the asteroid now, and we do have access to the sprite now. And we are going to execute now for each and every combination where a sprite is an asteroid and the other sprite is just something else, either the ship or the bullet. We're going to execute whatever code we are pasting in here. And this is now where we actually want to check, okay, do those two sprites, do they somehow collide? Do they overlap? And again, we are going to make use of the code that I was, or to this article I was referring to in this bit.ly link over there. Because in order to actually understand if two things do collide, we can just basically calculate the distance between both, which is done by similar to what we were doing earlier with this magnitude. So we're just going to understand, okay, what's the distance between the sprite and the asteroid and the sprite based on their X and Y properties. Then we are calculating the distance based on this. And now if they do collide, which basically means if the distance between both, if the distance between both is shorter than the sum of their radiuses, or in our case, we take the radius, we take the width of our object. And if that's the case, if the distance is smaller, they do overlap and they do collide, basically. And now because a sprite is considered no longer alive or dead when you actually hit TTL of zero, we are basically saying, okay, this asteroid which was hitting this particular other sprite, if they do collapse, if they do collide, then we are going to kind of kill both of these entities. And this is done by setting the TTL to just zero. Okay. So now, assuming that some sprite was hitting some asteroid, we have set this TTL to zero, which means the moment we hit this particular code over here, both of these sprites are going to disappear because isAlive is going to return false, which means it's going to be filtered out by this particular line. And I can just show you what will happen now, which is you can basically now shoot against those asteroids, and the moment the bullet actually hits the asteroid, they are going to disappear. So both the bullet and the actual asteroid are going to disappear. All right, so collision detection done. We have bullets which can shoot asteroids, but as you can probably recall from the original game, this is only like half of what we really want to have. And the last bit I would really like to focus on today is splitting those asteroids into smaller chunks. And this is rather straightforward because we have already everything that we need available, except for tiny, tiny tweaks that we have to do, which is we are going to parameterize the create asteroid function. So we are going to allow passing an X and a Y position, and also a radius, which by default is just going to be 30. So now here, we're just going to remove this, which means from the outside, if you just call create asteroid without any parameters, then X will be 100, Y will be 100 as before, and also radius will be 30 as before. And now here at the very bottom where we are checking if something was hitting the asteroid here, we want to do the following. We want to create new asteroids. So if the asteroid's radius is greater than, let's say, 10 or something like this, then we are just going to create new asteroids at the position where this asteroid was originally, but we make them smaller. Right, so the big asteroid will kind of disappear and it will crack, so to speak. And instead we will create smaller asteroids at the same position which are going to fly around somewhere else. And we can just do this by now creating, and I'm going to use a for loop again. We are going to create three asteroids. And we're going to push those asteroids into our sprites array again. And we can now use create asteroid. And we're now going to pass the original position of our asteroid. So the X is going to be the same as the asteroid ones. The Y position is going to be the same as the asteroid ones. And now the radius can be totally up to you. We can, for example, do, okay, please take the radius of the original asteroid and remove 10. It's going to be 10 pixels smaller than the original asteroid. And now, let's see if this works. It did not. Why is that? Because I wasn't using X. Here we go. Oop. So now I can see how you are hitting the asteroid by a bullet with a bullet, and it kind of disappears, but instead of the original one, three smaller ones to appear and then just move somewhere. like move randomly across the entire screen. And this is now happening 2 times, or you can also change it, you know, just by tweaking this particular parameter over here. So what's the minimum size of an asteroid? And then you can also tweak this one if you like. So you could create different kind of iterations based on what you like. So that's essentially what I wanted to show you today. So quick summary of what I was telling you, you know, Contra is a framework for building tiny, tiny JavaScript games based on the actual web canvas. It comes with a game loop, which kind of updates your game 60 times per second and also re-renders the page respectively. And all of these entities that you can see in your game inside of the Contra universe, they are called sprites. And you can have either images, or you can have rectangles, or you can have any sort of custom shapes that you like that you can create with the web canvas. And you have learned about this DX property, which, you know, continuously statically moves stuff around. And then you have also seen this DDX or DDY property, which is a delta to the actual data of some position, which allows you to accelerate and decelerate certain movements smoothly. What else have we done? We have seen how you can, you know, kill an entity using this TTL and is alive properties and functions. And this is basically what we have now. You have a game where you can shoot those asteroids and you can kind of split them. And now obviously there isn't, first of all, there is no end in that sense. So you cannot win the game or you cannot lose the game in that sense. It's just your ship will disappear at some point. So now what you could do as next step really is tweak this even further. So you can add, you know, a winning screen when you have managed to actually crack all of those asteroids. And how this could look like really is something like this. So there is also this directory inside of this project, which is called Go Crazy. And, you know, just afterwards, if you like, have a look into this. Basically, I was adding some more colors, some more backgrounds, some more everything. And it looks like this just afterwards. And if you wanted to take it to the next level, I actually wanted to show you 2013's winner of JS Thuringia Games. So again, this is well in the boundaries of 13 kilobytes and perfectly matching our topic that we have seen today. So this is what it could be in the long run if you add more visuals and more features and also more, more everything, a little bit of everything here and there. So this is what you can do.
And the cool part about Radius Write is that the source code is available on GitHub, so you can actually check how the game was built.
Would you like to paste it?
The source code?
Yes. Paste the link to the source code.
Sure.
Cool. Yeah, maybe to give you some hints on what else to look into if you wanted to go into this direction of creating those tiny, tiny games. There is, first of all, a library which is called ZCFX, which is a synthesizer for JavaScript. And you can, I'm just going to paste this link here because usually the sound doesn't work for, like if I want to transfer the sound, doesn't work. You can basically play sounds by, you know, pressing any of these buttons and it will generate you JavaScript code. So you basically take a library which is called ZCFX, which is super, super small. And then afterwards you can call these kind of functions which will generate you random, well, will generate you sounds which you might have tweaked just upfront. So this is for sounds. You can basically, with rather a few lines of JavaScript, you can kind of create sounds inside of your game. And then also, if you wanted to draw text on your canvas, you can use this tiny font JS library over here, and I'm going to share this thing as well, which allows you to render any sort of text on a canvas, and it's only really 700 bytes in size, so it should perfectly fit into your 13 kilobytes that you may have. And last but not least, those 13 kilobytes aren't pure and raw JavaScript code. You can actually zip those source code files, and you can afterwards, you know, try to use different kind of tools which make your zip files as small as possible. And there is this tool which is called ECT, which allows you to recompress existing zip files, and it makes it usually around about 10 to 20% smaller than the original zip file. So if you're interested in really getting the most out of file sizes in that sense, you can have a look into this and benefit from it. And last but not least, there is this kind of template which I like to use, which comes with a Webpack like bundling mechanism. And you have like the source code, the source directory over here where you have, where you're going to have all your actual JavaScript source code. Then you run a command, yarn build in that case, which will take all of the source code and kind of compress it and make a single index.html file out of it, which you can then afterwards use to kind of ship your game and even zip your game. There is a question. Is an example using screens for Contra? Maybe Steven, you can reply to this.
Yeah, so Contra comes with a scene class, which I'll post there, which kind of will let you handle the screens, as you've called it. There's an example on, so inside the Contra GitHub repo is a bunch of examples. One of them is on scene handling different things. So here, so kind of how to handle different scenes in a game, like a pause scene, high score, main menu, things of that nature.
That's actually good to know. So just FYI, and I guess apparently that's not the way you're supposed to do it. So here, first of all, you have the source code to this game I was building in 2019, which reads basically dungeon, but backwards, because the topic was called back. Obviously, nobody is hindering you from kind of pausing all your animations and everything that you're drawing on the canvas. So the moment you stop updating your entities, they will kind of freeze, right? So this is what I was trying to use here in this particular game. So every time you have these kind of overlays, everything that is happening in the background, it is still rendered, but it's no longer updated, which means the state of each of those entities is no longer changing. So this is my way of using like screens, how you refer to it, I believe. And this, apparently there are other options to actually do this. Any more questions? Does Contra support WebGL?
So Contra does not support WebGL. It just uses the canvas. If you, for the JavaScript 13K specifically, WebGL can get complex, and minifying that into 13K is a bit of a hassle, so it's just Canvas. If you're looking for libraries that support WebGL that you don't care about the file size, then there's Phaser, but Phaser is large. You won't be able to get it for 13K games.
All right. Last but not least, I wanted to mention more time. So this workshop was part of a series of events that we are running in under the umbrella of JS 13K Games, which is, as said, a game coding competition, which you can see here. And it is running for another 27 days, as you can see here. So you can, if you feel like you want to, you know, submit your own game to this competition, you have lots of time. Maybe Andrzej, you want to mention just some more things here, you know, promote your baby.
There is still plenty of time to build something. I highly encourage submitting what you build. Sometimes, like, it doesn't have to be impressive. Like, don't worry too much about people who spend months every year building some entries, because the screenshots of their progress could be impressive and intimidating. But the competition is mostly for fun. Of course, there are prizes, but I think what is the best in this competition is that even though there are prizes, people will gladly help each other So if you have any issues, any problems, ask on Slack, and you'll most probably get the answer from all those people, all those hardcore participants. So if you have any issues, if you have any problems, please ask there, and I'm more than sure that you will get your answer. So yeah, submit a game. There's a high chance of winning a t-shirt, which is shipped for free worldwide. If you will not end up in top 100, then there are other ways to get it.
All right. Yeah, that's essentially the end of this session today. I hope that was somewhat interesting. I know I was rushing it a little bit, but yeah, in past years I was easily making like 3 hours out of this, but I hope it was somewhat interesting. And yeah, as said, totally take the time to look into the repository I was pasting earlier and like the final version of the game. So stuff that you are seeing here is in the, I believe it's the 9th. Yeah, the asteroid splitting bit. So the entire code that I was just writing is in this particular directory over here. And yeah, thanks for dialing in. Feel free to ask any more questions if you like, maybe even, you know, turn on your camera if you like, but otherwise that's it for the day, or for the, at least for me, evening. And yeah, thanks for participating.
Thanks so much for running it.
You are welcome. I will stop recording now. Where is it?
Thank you.